Okay, one last time. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm sure you're sick and tired of hearing from me. But the good news is that this is the last time as we move into our last session with our panel of executives here before we also close our conference this evening with our gala dinner. Thank you to all of you. We'll still have more people filtering in. There's no question about that, but we're going to carry on now just again in the interest of time. Thank you all again for coming and sharing the day with us and for participating and staying now until the end. You won't regret it. And even if you do, there's going to be some drinks afterwards so you can, you know, drink your way through the sorrow, I suppose. Yeah. That's obviously what we spend most of our time in automotive logistics doing. A quick reminder, once again, the evaluation forms that I mentioned in the last session are on your chairs in front of you. If you haven't filled one out, please do so by the end of this session. You know, I repeat myself, but we really value. We have meetings where we're going to almost go through, you know, line by line what people say critically, positively, and we really do listen and try to respond. And again, with the first conference, we'd like to think we get a lot of things right, but we don't pretend to be perfect by any means. Well, Louis a little bit, but he can get away with that, I think. No, we really would value that. And just a reminder that we do have that prize draw, the Mercedes-Benz hat for the lucky winner that we'll pull out of a different hat. So I don't think you get the hat that we take the evaluation forms from. Okay, I think, you know, I don't need to run through everything that we've talked about today. You know, I'm sure it's all fresh on your mind. I think it's been really interesting. We've gone through a lot. And I think if there's one message, it's that a change is coming. Changes are definitely coming. We can't necessarily spell them out in precision. You know, when it comes to Brexit, we talk through some of the scenarios, the many scenarios, the potential scenarios. Some of them more worrying than others in terms of the automotive supply chain. But there seems no scenario, a very unlikely situation where the status quo or something even too close to the status quo is going to remain. There will be change. And some of that will be painful, but there will be opportunities. And through all of it, logistics will be there and will need to respond. So I think that's a point that one way or another we need to be ready for in terms of Brexit. But Brexit is only one thing. We talked quite a bit about technology, whether that's move towards electrification, hybrids, you know, alternative fuels, lighter weight vehicles, and all of that, which is of course important to consumers, but as we've heard, can have big impacts for the supply chain as well. It's not the time, according to the professor this morning, to be investing in camshaft suppliers, I guess. You know, the clock is ticking on some, potentially clicking on some parts of the supply chain, maybe, which will change as we move to electric vehicles. We need in the supply chain to be ready to adapt to these technologies. Industry 4.0, whatever, automation, big data, all the opportunities that come in the supply chain. These are very relevant to the UK. You know, let's say a high value, higher cost location. As I mentioned this morning, high complexity, often space constraints. So we need to use every inch, every centimeter for you Europeans there. We need to be ready for that. And so we heard about some of the potential. You saw some interesting presentations about what it could mean in ports, in plants from Jaguar Land Rover. And again, whether or not it's happening tomorrow or 2 years from now, we need to be ready. So a change is coming. With that view, we have a chance to talk through some of those topics and trends with some important decision makers at both major logistics providers and, of course, car makers. We're going to have a presentation, a short presentation from Luc Nadal, who's the chairman of the GEFCO group. And then we'll move to our Q&A format. We're very pleased to have Levent Yuksel from Jaguar Land Rover join us. And of course, welcoming back to the stage, to the podium here, or to the stage, is Alan Draper, of course, from Ford, and some other guy at the end there. So we're both going to be posing questions to our panel, but before and of course we'll be looking to you to hopefully participate, put in your views, and really take advantage of the opportunity to ask these important gentlemen their views. So before we do that, though, I would like to hand over the podium to Luc Nadal.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for the opportunity to discuss with you inside that panel. Just a very short presentation to give you a quick update of about GEFCO. So thanks to an acquisition, we are now becoming real global, as we are now in the US, Australia, and other geographies in Southeast Asia where we were not. That's the acquisition of IGS, who now is rebranded GEFCO, GEFCO Forwarding. GEFCO, it's mainly to conceive, integrate, and operate logistics solution. And I would like to make an update on three components of that. The first one is about warehousing and international footprint with regard to warehousing. We are not very focused on FMCG kind of business when we talk about warehousing, but much more on logistic platforms for industrial. And you see on that slide where we are. And we have built some international logistic platforms in France, in UK, Slovakia, China, and Mexico for the automotive industry. And especially the news of the year is our investment in the UK for 11,600 square meters. Where we are building a facility dedicated to your industry. Clearly, a UK car manufacturer trust in GEFCO services, and thanks to this trust, we have decided to make that investment, which is open to clearly to all of you. Also in the UK, we have, I wouldn't say entered a new business because we used to do that for our past mother company, PSA, since decades. But we are now entering that business for other OEMs, and we intend to bring some optimization thanks to normalization of those containers. And we have developed this know-how and exported it to the UK, which is a second very important move for GEFCO UK. And we expect to enlarge this to other European plants. And we are also, and it's probably the part of our activity where we have made the more changes, because I think, as you said, logistics is really moving fast. We are increasing the added value services around our finished vehicle logistics. We see that more and more it will be much more than car transportation. We are in the country of fleet and defleet, and we see that there is plenty of opportunities to bring additional services to the car industry, not only the OEMs, but also the leasing company. My only wish, being today in the UK, is that as we are an international company with a lot of international profile, and I see in that room a very talented and young Hungarian guy who is now leading GEFCO UK, I really cross my finger so that the country stays open for talents. Otherwise, we would be in a big difficulty. So that's my message about GEFCO. We're moving on. And in the UK, we really put a significant focus on container management, flow pack and full pack, meaning owning the containers or not owning the containers, finished vehicle logistics with added services in our compound and our beautiful new warehouse. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Luc. That sort of sets the scene a little there about what's happening with GEFCO. I think you pick up on the fact that a company maybe, or obviously with its roots in France and born of a car maker, is now a global company, even in the US and in places where maybe some of its traditional customers might not even be. So you see those developments. I can only echo your hopes on the openness side of things. I think if this industry was suddenly had to become quite nationally enclosed, we would be in quite a lot of trouble, as you can see from our own panel, from the room. Hopefully that's not.
However, if because of political decisions, I would like to qualify them because I'm not so sure that they are good. But if this leads to having a new custom clearance at the border of UK, I'm sure that GEFCO will be able to handle that as we do at the Turkish border or at the Russian border. It's not what we would like to do, but I think it will not be a big turmoil in the supply chain.
Okay, well, that's a fair point to raise. There's an opportunity there. Maybe it's not an opportunity that would be so Jaguar Land Rover might be so happy to have to deal with, but as you point out, there is that, if those are reality, those are the ones we have to deal with.
This is not what we want for our customer, for sure.
I guess the first question that I would want to raise, because I mean, we've talked through the scenarios, we're not going to solve anything with Brexit here, and there's maybe some limits to what some can even talk about. But in terms of the readiness of your companies to adapt to these potential changes, how would you rate the kind of readiness? Maybe we can start with Alan. Obviously, you outlined this morning quite precisely Ford's desires, obviously, but whether or not we get all of those is very much an open question. How ready and able would Ford be to respond to some of, let's say, the more worst-case scenarios?
Yeah, I think all of the OEMs, we talked about Jaguar Land Rover, I'm sure, but also Nissan, the other larger ones in the UK, will have the same issue. They've got to find a way to successfully manage through the political situation and the economic impact of the situation. But we've done this before around the world. It's not the first time we've had significant changes either. You know, we talked about an exchange rate change, but in terms of tariff changes, and we've always found ways through them. They've happened in South America over the last 10 years. They happened in North America actually before that, where we broke down some of the barriers. So there are places in the world where they happen, and we've always found ways through them. There's a cost to everything. So at the end of the day, we have to manage our way through those costs. We want to give the best value we can to our customers, so it's important we try and minimize those costs. And I think that's how I would see it. We'll find a sensible way through this with working in close cooperation both with the EU Commission and the governments in the EU and with the UK government. That's a requirement. And as I said, so far those discussions are taking place in a very sensible and positive way.
Okay. Yeah, from our point of view, actually today there was quite a number of talks about the implications, but obviously at heart we are a British company, but we are competing in the global arena, so we see ourselves a global company. And from that point of view, in this morning also there was some indications that although we are expanding the capacity in the UK as our base, however we are not staying only enclosed in the UK. We are growing internationally. So recently we have announced a manufacturing plant in Slovakia, which will take place and which will be producing 150,000 vehicles in the coming years. And this morning Richard has illustrated that we have our plant in Brazil, started operation. We have joint venture in China, and we have a contract agreement with Magna Steyr. So this indicates that we are having a balanced approach, being a global company, home base being in the UK. However, we are, looking at a global perspective. Of course, the Europe is a big market and very, very important market for us. And we always value the importance of European market, and we want to value our customer base, and we want to value our products in the Europe. Hence, we are engaged with the UK government, EU Commission, EU Parliament, and all the relevant bodies to identify the importance of a tariff-free trade between Britain and the EU, while preserving the existing labor regulations and the other rules in place. However, this is not, I think, the end of the story. We are working and looking from a global perspective, and we are expanding while sweating the assets in the UK, also looking from a more global perspective to meet the customers' demand all over the world, because it's a balanced portfolio. When you look into Jaguar Land Rover customer base, definitely valuing the Europe market, it may have an impact if we have tariffs. Hence, we are expecting a positive progression in the talks in the days to come.
I think that the automotive sector will be much less impacted than the financial one. The automotive sector, all our customers, all OEMs are very global. They are all around the world. And I can tell you that the crisis in Argentina, when you see the pesos dropping by 20% or even more in one day, changing all the logic for the OEMs, and the production cost is something we have overcome, us logistic companies, but also our customers. And I think that with that regard, Brexit story is much of less importance, even if psychologically speaking, it's a tremendous change for all European, including a French one. Mm-hmm. What I see is that during the next years, if we do not have the rules early, it will probably limit the investment for the next 24 or 36 months. And that's a question for UK. But otherwise, in the long term, I don't think that it will be a tremendous change.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. A question from me is it is the Automotive Logistics UK conference, and often when you think of, you know, the British, sometimes think of eccentricities. So what is peculiar, what's different, what's unusual about the UK supply chain, doing logistics in the UK as opposed to the rest of Europe or elsewhere? Levent.
Okay.
I like picking on Levent.
Thank you. We like each other. Actually, there are some peculiarities, UK being an island, and definitely when we compare with the continent Europe, you could have more opportunities for reverse flows. You could have more opportunities for combined activities to make use of the scales of economy and make use of the scales of activity moving back and forth in the different parts of the continent. And in the UK, definitely it is having a big part of the supply chain in the Europe as well. However, still we have this channel in the middle. And this year we have experienced quite a number of events, and that's going back to last year as well, that has risked our supply chain because of the conflicts in the Calais and other congestion and things alike have put our supply chain under stress. So this is an essential factor. Although we were with our logistic partners and with the support of our network, we could manage without being detrimentally affected. But it was a threat, and it's an ongoing threat. So you don't feel this in the continent. So there are some peculiarities, but I think with the open collaboration with the logistic partners and the other parties, I think we have a good resilience about working collaboratively to overcome and to be still competitive, because we can't have excuses. It's a very competitive environment. Although we have some peculiarities, only unique to this country, it's very globally competitive. and we are always looking for ways of working together effectively and inviting good ideas, inviting good innovations to make seamless. And this morning we have been discussing different ideas of the data, available data, and how can we use that data to connect the supply chain and have better visibility. And also we are working on software system in terms of the predictability of the risks to come, mm-hmm. which is some predictive analysis and et cetera. So the technology is there. And we are looking forward to make this a value-added output for our planning process, for our actions, and being resilient against the things happening around us.
Mm-hmm. Luc?
I would say the first characteristic is that the trucks are running the wrong side
not
of the
road. The correct side.
On top of that, I think that the key point is clearly the fact that UK is an island. Yeah. Flows are not that badly balanced. Mm-hmm. There are imports, there are exports. And for sure, logistic companies and OEMs need to be prepared for crisis. For example, we have moved our flows 1 year ago, the Calais strike, because all OEMs are using Zeebrugge as a port of export, and the poor company crossing the channel only with PSA cars couldn't reload. So one characteristic is that it creates natural gateways, and volumes bring volumes and cost reduction. So this is something we do not see in other geographies. We had to move to that port for cost reasons. But by the way, and we are quite lucky because we made that decision before the crisis in Calais, we also need to be flexible to change when a crisis occurs. And Calais has been in real crisis. I'm not speaking about finished vehicle, but inbound logistics. And it's our duty to be able to anticipate that and to move to find other ways. It has a cost. OEMs fully understand that. We share that. On the other hand, the fact of being an island makes that you have gateways and you have potential to bundle flows. So it has also some positive side. That's what I would say. Real estate in the UK, it's probably a little different than on the continent. I was talking about a warehouse. It's clear that on some parts of the UK, there is a lack of capacities. And OEMs and logistic companies has to follow their project and to be real on time to be able to serve new capabilities, new plans. Mm-hmm. That's the main difference I see.
This is not my area of expertise, but let me have make a couple of comments. Now, I'm pretty optimistic about the way that the UK shipments, freight lines all run. We have very few problems into our engine plants where we produce 1.5 million engines. And that's basically because a lot of expertise of people in the room, people know what they're doing. In fact, our biggest risks tend to be when we have catastrophic events at suppliers. So just to give you an example, this is a stable environment. You know? We were talking about Kyoto in Japan in the last few weeks. I've got a supplier there that's had two major earthquakes and one tornado gone through the site over the last 2 to 3 months. And so we've been air freighting everything we can get out of those sites. Fortunately, we had, from the previous tsunami, established a second source of supply, but we obviously couldn't get everything from that second source. So, you know, in the global world, there are more dangerous places to be. And so I think you know, we're doing a good job here as well, though, in the way we run the operations.
Mm-hmm. Is there a good supply base in the UK?
Mm-hmm. The UK supply base is variable, so there are some areas where it's still got good strength and some where over the years the supply base has basically moved to other parts of the world. I think we buy around about 10 to 12% of our total material buy in Europe from the UK, so it's a reasonable amount. A lot of strength in the casting industry, still some of those sort of materials, chassis components, etc. But not so much in the electronics, which basically has gone out to China and Japan, etc. So it varies, but overall, where we can buy in the UK for logistics reasons, we obviously do because of the freight benefit of having production local to our assembly plants.
Has that been a particular focus, and this is both for Ford and Jaguar Land Rover, to increase that? I mean, obviously, we talk about export benefit from a weak pound, but if you're importing a lot, then you lose that benefit to a large degree. So, you know, how localized are the engine plants specifically, and have you seen that increase? Mm-hmm. And perhaps, Levin, you can also talk about that from a JLR mm-hmm. perspective as well.
When I was talking about 10%, I'm talking about 10% of the total European business. Obviously, in the engine plants, it's significantly more than that, probably about 40% plus of material. But you're right, there will obviously be, as I said earlier, the fact that we buy a lot of components in dollars, so raw materials are in dollars, so as soon as everything from petroleum to the plastic raw materials suddenly increases, so those suppliers will come to us and say there is an issue, and we'll work through that issue with the suppliers usually. And it seems to work okay, but what I do think is that it would be good if the pound could strengthen over the next 2 or 3 years. But in the short term, you can understand the effect. But if it stays that level, it will basically increase the cost of those materials that we're buying for the UK sites. Mm.
Yeah. I think what's happening around us is that we have an approach of a total cost of ownership, which balances the purchasing product and also with the logistics factors and all others, and also best cost sourcing mentality. And we don't stick to one significant area. We make a real comprehensive business decision when we go for sourcing. And in one of our recent models, when we were going for the sourcing, and what we have observed, looking at, as I mentioned earlier on, we are growing globally, and we don't restrict ourselves with the sourcing exclusively from the UK. But it happened to be that maybe slightly over 50% eventually happened to be that sourcing from the UK. So and going back to your question, Louis, it looks like still a real vibrant supply base in the UK, and they are also improving their competitiveness. So we look from a very, objective way of approaching, and it proves out to be still in good shape and place.
Just obviously you're here, so if you want to interrupt our very pleasant conversation here, you're more than welcome.
Yeah.
So our team's very old, so it takes them a while to get. And Gavin's actually one of the oldest, so be gentle with him.
My apologies. Thousand apologies. My name is Willem Adrian from Quartet. I had a question. In the last couple of days, we had last week the Paris Motor Show, where a lot of the CEOs presented. One of the key things there was mentioned is that the fall of the British pound after the Brexit has led to problems for the car manufacturers, in the sense that they want to recoup some of the losses they made because of the fall in the British pound. So one after the other is increasing the prices by 1.5% to 2%. Opel did that, Nissan did that, Peugeot did that, they're all doing it. And they said that the increase that they've put through now will not be sufficient to recoup the losses they got from this effect, which means that somewhere down the line, somebody has to make up for that difference that we've now lost. Would you say that would put the supply chain under more pressure to find cost reductions, and thus, for example, a provider like GEFCO, who will see that then as an impact on their business?
If I may, being under pressure, I think that that kind of event will not change the level of pressure, because pressure is present. Pressure on cost and reliability, it's the sea in which we are swimming every day. So I think that the consequences of that will be on the P&L of the OEMs trying to recover, but it will not change the behaviors with logistics suppliers and supply chain, because everybody is under pressure. Tier 1, Tier 2, logistics supplier. This economy is just incredible. When you go to the to the show in Paris and you see the price of the cars, and I probably said already that in Bonn, but 30 years ago it was the same price, and you have a better car than today for the same price. So they erased, we all of us, we erased more than inflation, which is just incredible. So pressure is definitely here, but maybe I'm wrong.
We should always work on becoming more efficient. I mean, that's what we do. I think if there's anybody here that's not working on being more efficient, then probably they're not working in the automotive industry. It's just what we have to do. And it's because of what we have to do, because we need to give the customers, you know, the product they want, but we also obviously have responsibilities to our shareholders and to our business partners. So we work on that, but you're right, this is a one-off situation, but most of the companies, I think, will take a longer-term view of this. How do we manage effectively through it? And there are efficiencies we'll make inside the OEMs. I think all the companies have been doing that. And if you look at what PSA has done the last few years, as have many others, we've worked on our internal efficiency. There's an efficiency with the supplier base, but we work in partnership to achieve that. And at the end of it, the companies that work with us tend to be the stronger companies. You know, you get a strength from becoming more efficient in the global competitive world, and so that's not a bad thing to do.
I would agree with the comments with Alan. Actually, for one, we can't put the burden on the customer. That's for sure. We need to work with our supply chain, with our partners, to absorb, because the economical environment, climate is changing. This time it may be adverse, the next time it could be on our benefit. But we can't reflect every change in our operating environment to our customers. That is, we need to protect the customer. That's first. Secondly, as highlighted, we have a already tight but very collaborative relationship with our suppliers. Because for a sustainable business, we can't again reflect every hit with which we have directly reflect to the supplier, because we need to develop our competitiveness as a one team, and this is something that we can have the hit this time, but again looking into our way of reacting and maintaining the sustainable, because if in the hard times we push the blame or the pressure more on the supply base, and if it is in a tailwind, then we need to reward them, then this changes the dynamics of increasing our competitiveness day after day. We are working jointly, both in our operations and with our supply base, to how can we improve our competitiveness and offer high technology, as you say, state-of-the-art products with a more reasonable and more affordable prices, while keeping sustainable relationship with our supply base. This is our key drive, and there are sometimes headwinds, sometimes tailwinds.
Not to point fingers at others, but I think if you look at what happened over the summer with Volkswagen, a couple of providers, unilaterally trying to change a price or change a contract, for example, really turning the screw on a supplier can be very dangerous as well, as most of the plants in Germany found out for that. So as you talked about, maybe optimization over time might be one thing, but I mean, supplier relations to me should be maintained, and I maybe you can comment to the degree that has that been a focus for your companies to improve those. I mean, in the U.S. there's a quite notable survey that comes out every year which ranks the car makers, and you know, they seem to respond pretty forcefully when they fall down in those rankings. I don't know of an equivalent in Europe, but nonetheless, is that something that you're tracking on the side?
Okay, let me make another comment. Yes, we do look at those ratings, those surveys, in great detail. I mean, our objective has always been to improve supplier relationships, because you know, we do know that if you want to have the best technology for the future, you want to have suppliers that can develop that for you and deliver it for you. So it's not just, you know, it's the best systems, it's the best capability. It's getting, you know, that available to your company as an OEM. So if you're basically the OEM of choice, the ones that they most want to deal with, then you're going to get better response, and the better you build a partnership, usually the more you can find as opportunity. And as a company, you know, when we work through with our major suppliers, you know, a lot of it is, you know, how do we find opportunities for both companies? And there are many. As I said, the optimistic thing I've got is that, in my mind, is that the auto industry is a major growth industry over the next 10, 15, 20 years. There's just more opportunity as growth occurs all around the world. And so how do we find that? Some suppliers we may have issues with because of the economic situation in Brazil, but they're able to grow something in China. And we look at that. We look at the global world and say, how do you best find an opportunity for a company because they're our partners? So that's quite important for us.
I think for us it's a partnership, and when we talk about partnership, it's long-term relationship. And from that point of view, this morning Richard alluded that we have 9,000 engineers for development, but this is never enough. The scale of growth and the scale of challenge, we need to rely on our suppliers' core competency and their capability to grow mutually, to grow together. And this calls for a long-term relationship. And we see that the results of developing and growing with the suppliers always produces better results in the long run. And from that point of view, we try to establish enduring relationship, but both challenging each other in one hand, and on the other hand, helping each other. So what we have done in the recent years, we've seen some of our suppliers were struggling to understand our systems, to cope with our challenging environment, because it's a very complex world. So we established a supplier development team within MPNL Logistics Group. And now we are sending our team to go and help to work with them, to be inside their facilities, to be inside their teams, to work together to produce a better result instead of just making pressure or just asking why not. So this is a kind of relationship that we want to establish and grow mutually in this competitive environment. Yeah.
Without partnership, there are things that in our industry we cannot do. Some investment which are obvious, like investment in rail car. You know that now cars are a little taller than they used to be. So if you want to balance flows, you need to have some versatile rail cars. It can be huge investment, and we cannot do that without a kind of partnership. We are talking about automatic without driver truck in the next 5 or 10 years. People are considering that it will be available in 5 years' time. Then we will have the question of the legislation in Europe to make sure that all countries are moving at the same time. But that will need new technologies for the logistic companies to handle that, new investment. That means we need to invent the way to load and unload at both sides, because the truck will probably not be able to unload itself. So there are plenty of changes for which we really need to discuss with our customer and to rely on long-term, demanding but long-term relation. Otherwise, we will not succeed. It's also the same with some IT development.
Right. Just to follow up to Alan on that, you haven't spoken for about 5 years at our conference, so I've saved them all up for you, Alan. But just on the UK, I mean, one of your roles is, you know, global cost savings. No, sorry, global team value management. Yeah, not cost savings at all. But when you get a task, whatever it is, 100 million, 500 million, do you think, UK, there's quite a bit I can get out of the UK because of the inefficiencies? Are we relatively efficient and you would have to really, you know, fight hard to get, you can always find efficiencies, or do you think, there's some easy pickings in the UK?
The answer is no, I don't think it's easy. We look at this in terms of each individual supplier. We look at their cost structures, so we look at what is their cost, how efficient are they, where are their gaps against the benchmark of other suppliers in the industry, and then how do we work together to get to a more efficient position in the future. But that's not a national thing at all. We would talk to a supplier, so Faurecia is a French-based supplier but has got factories all around the world, including in the UK, and we talk to them about their whole business, not about the business just in the UK. Mm-hmm. Now, there may be a specific issue in the UK, but we then address that as part of the larger picture.
Well, first off, before I ask another question, does the audience have anything to add? Yes.
Gavin, when you stand there, you're supposed to hold the microphone to help.
Hello there, Stuart Warren from Group Cat. The other elephant in the room, apart from Brexit, may well be the very high level of storage of cars, of inventory held in the UK. and the stretched storage capacity that we've got in the UK. I think maybe that's exposed a trend in manufacturing that we are now no longer building to order, or at least many manufacturers, and building to stock or trying to anticipate sales rather than looking for the orders and then building the cars. Maybe 10 years ago, maybe even less, there was a big trend towards 3-day, 5-day car building to order. What's happened to that?
Luke, you want to get that first?
Okay. Yes, we have an action roadmap in terms of delivering the cars in a shortest possible time with the most efficient method. And the interesting thing is the demand is as we highlighted earlier on is a global demand. It's fluctuating and it's not reliable from one time to another. In the earlier session we have heard about some reliability of the forecast. Definitely it's for the benefit of the OEM and also supply base and also the distribution as and when we have that level of reliability. But there are so many factors and there are so many influencing elements around us and the market demands in parallel to that are showing a certain level of fluctuation. So from that point of view, we are trying to embed this into our planning process and delivery process. And moreover, we are trying to accommodate these fluctuations within the premises we have. So hence, we have made investments for our finished vehicle compounds in last year and also this year to balance and accommodate without reflecting this difficulty to the partners, service providers that we are working with. But there are some thresholds. At that point, we expect the joint, again, collaborative approach while we are working on the balancing the, while meeting the ever-changing customer demand. And today we also discuss about mass customization. This is also bringing a difficulty, a higher level of complexity to the business in terms of forecast predictability. So within all of these parameters, we are still trying to improve our resilience. And also we are looking forward to work more collaboratively to overcome these peaks and troughs.
Let me have a go at this one as well. I think we have continued to work on order to delivery. You know, here's the order, how quickly can we get that through the system to our customer? The longer a vehicle stays, you know, parked somewhere, in revenue terms, it's not a great thing to do, but also in terms of the customer's product, it's better to get it to them quickly. So we understand that, and that's what we try and do. In fact, the European market is an order-based market. People specify what they want. If you try and just build any type of vehicle and sell it in Germany, your success rate will be very low because people like to specify their vehicle. And it's the same in the UK to a large extent. Some other parts of the world, you can just build an order and take it out into the market and the dealer tries and sells it. But in a way, you've got 21 unique markets in many ways in Europe. You have to build specifically to the customer order and you have to deliver it as quickly as you can. Now, there can always be reasons why that gets delayed due to various factors, but the overall objective from Ford's side is to get those products built and through as quickly as we can.
Levent, you mentioned the complexity with customization and I mean a car maker like Jaguar Land Rover could probably brag about the number of varieties that you could, you know, almost infinite, right? I think Audi once told me, I don't know if it was the A4, one model had 10 to the 38th number, you know. But is there too much in reality, and is there, you know, is there an ability for purchasing or logistics to push back a little bit and to maybe find some standardization that might decrease some of this complexity, because obviously the knock-on effect in the supply base and in the plants in terms of handling this is quite enormous.
Actually, that's a fair point and very important discussion topic within our corridors, because as you highlight, trying to meet the customer demand, which is really going towards very much customization, which is going so vast and endless. On the other hand, we have some thresholds and we have some limitations in our, in the capability of holding materials and also finished vehicles and also in the premises in terms of the we can fit in a line, because we are working in flexible lines and we are working in we are sweating the assets and we are producing two or three products in the same line. Yeah. So these all bring challenges with us. So what we have done regarding this, we are working more with the development and engineering side to look into the derivatives and the options, because we are offering so much, but we are making an analysis of how many of them are we using, how many of them is there real demand. Yeah. Because sometimes we offer so much, but it's not being asked by the customer. Mm-hmm. So we have established, we have introduced a program which is called for Design for Logistics, yeah, which makes a more business sensible analysis of what we offer and what is the take rate in the market. And then we make a more reasonable analysis of whatever the customer needs, we will definitely keep it and we will definitely provide those to the customer. But if that is something very, very absurd combination of different colors or different parts engaged, then we try to drop it for the next model. So this is a more collaborative approach between the logistics and the supply chain with the engineering. So in the past, we didn't have that kind of good relation or good connection, right, which feeds the other part of the process to the earlier stages of the planning. And now we are moving into a stage that we have better understanding of the importance and value of the what complexity costs us. But whenever it is meaningful and reasonable for the customer, we will never cut that option away. Right. But whatever it is, not that we are not going to go for it.
As a logistic provider, we see that for the OEMs, it's fundamental to be close to the customer demand. Right. And a new customization can be very attractive to the market, and they need to provide that. On the other hand, the line does what it can, and logistic providers are able to generate post-production operation. Inside GEFCO, we are doing some customizations with paintings. You know the matte painting? We used to do that. I think it's not so much on demand right now. But some years ago, we were doing that for our clients, because it was not possible to do that inside in plant. So they do that afterwards. So on compounds, on the logistic flow, you can generate part, not all, but part of the customization. Mm. Wheels, things like that, it can be mounted in post-production operation by logistic suppliers without lengthening the delivery time.
Just another thought again, it's a lot to do with actually interest rates. If you look at European interest rates, they're pretty low. So the cost of borrowing is low. So people will feel that they can make a vehicle to a higher specification than they normally would have done in a different environment. So what that's meant, in fact, in Ford is that our marketing plans, which are developed, say, 3 years before the vehicle goes into mass production, it might be out of date because people have moved on. When we launched some of our products, we found that our high series was taking 70%. Now, normally it would be 30% or 40%. So as that's grown, people want more options, and you have to find ways to satisfy their demand. Otherwise, you're not giving the customer what they want. So we have to be aware of that. But the other side of it, we do look at, I remember in Cologne on the Fiesta, we had 430 different wiring looms, the electrical looms that go into the vehicles, and we just couldn't get any more into the factory. We couldn't sequence any more. And so we looked at that, and as I said, the markets had moved on. We found some options with only 1%, 2% takes, and we took them down. So I think we went from down by about 30% and still managed to satisfy all the customer demands. So you have to look at both. To be efficient, you don't want too much complexity, but you also want to meet the customer demand at the end of the day. If you can't give the customers what they want, then if the rest of the OEMs are saying they will, then they'll make a choice. So we have to be conscious of that.
Supply chain, actually, we'll take a question from the...
I have a question for the panel. Ruud Vossenbelt from Inform. Some people say trucks are only utilized for 17% on the day, so there is a lot to win. I think that's also what Uber is saying about taxis. And I believe there still can be done a lot, either with hardware or with software, to bring in much more utilization, efficiency. Question to all of you is, where do you see that the biggest waste is today, and where you can win most in the coming years, using either software or hardware?
For me, if I can start with it. Actually, this morning, Richard has made some explanation about we are looking at our operations, and we are looking at from all aspects. And definitely the utilization of software and available data, which is a big enabler for us to reshape and optimize, because we are going through a transformation program for our logistics, and we can't do that with our the good old methods. Definitely there is a big need for efficiency and connectivity, because the future is all related with connectivity and lightweight and electrification. So these all link up to, as a supply chain planning and designing, we need to utilize the available technology to the best we can, and with a reasonable way, because sometimes, again, there were some discussions about, are we having too much data? That actually, there is a reasonable usage of the data and need for the data, as we highlighted in our overview of the supply chain transformation. And we are in route of identifying how we can make the best use of the available technology with yourselves, with people who have the core competency to develop. And we have the need over there, and we are up for a transformation, and we want to incorporate these kind of efficient tools and methods to achieve that competitive edge, because as we were discussing, all the dynamics around us bringing new challenges. And we can't, as we discussed earlier, we can't put an extra cost to the end product. So it's all about bringing efficiencies, and I think the technology is a big enabler for this.
By GEFCO, we used to say that GEFCO's values comes from the trust of the customers, the knowledgeable people inside the company, and the IT. As an integrator, we are reasonably asset light, and I can tell you that a large part of our investment, and I think that it will even increase, is about IT tools to bring more optimization and track and trace, because often customers, they want to know where their goods are. Sometimes I do not really know why they want that, but they want that. So, no, I mean, what a customer would like to know is that, compared to a commitment, there will be a problem. The question of the data is very important. What you want to know is when things will fail. Not that they have failed, when they will fail. To provide to PSA that we are delivering spare parts at 99.98%, is meaningless. The key point is the dealer who did not receive his parts with a big customer. That's a problem for our customer. On the other hand, for sure, technology will be key, is already key, and will be key in the future. On the other hand, I think we also need to push some lines. Spare parts, we deliver that by night. We open the door, we put the spare parts, we close the door. And if there is a complaint, we have found procedures with the dealers about the fact, yes, we have delivered. We flash, we measure, and we have no claim on that. Why can't we imagine to deliver cars by night? What is the technology we need to bring to the dealership to be able to unload a truck by night, when there is nobody on the road? You know, to join this meeting, I took the car with my colleagues in Coventry. I have seen trucks and trucks, and it was real mess on the motorway. And I have seen some of my competitors' truck, Finnish vehicles, stuck in the traffic. If we could enlarge the capabilities to unload, we will bring a lot of value to our customers. And it will not be a big deal for us to manage that. So it's about IT, but I think it's also about new ideas and opening our mind.
We have a question.
Simon Reynish from the Chartered Institute of Logistics and Transport. Picking up on your last point, when will you get to the tipping point between the number of units and increased growth of sales, which we were so eloquently illustrated this morning by a colleague from PwC, that you won't that the supply chain will actually stall and you won't be able to get your raw materials and parts into your production facilities to actually make and continue with that growth of product?
Did you pick?
The question.
Did you need to hear it again? Did you understand?
No.
It's all to do with congestion.
Oh, congestion.
Okay. With the growth of car sales, you're going to get to a tipping point where you won't actually have any room to have your trucks on the road to actually make the product. Okay. How close are we to actually get that congestion in the UK is going to actually affect the supply chain and of automotive logistics?
You understood that?
Yeah. I do not have any precise measures, but we see that between the number of hours, the capabilities we have, and the time it takes, I mean, there is a huge spending on that. The key point is how to have the measure of that. And obviously, we do not have the measure about an ideal scheme and the present situation. But
I think I can't answer the UK. We had some concerns in Cologne in the Ford assembly plant over the last 2 or 3 years. It was down to the fact that basically the road infrastructure around Cologne and the bridges particularly were built in the 60s and 70s. They're starting to decay, and so they can't take some of the heavy truck traffic at the moment, which means that people have to go on alternative routes. So what we've had to do in some cases is to actually change the logistic plan so that the time window delivery has been changed or so extended, or we've actually stocked or moved materials through either a warehouse or sometimes through our industry park. So you've moved it through an industry park. So we had to sometimes change the logistics to meet the actual fact of changes on the road structure. And I think that's an issue that will happen in the UK as road transport, you know, as the amount of traffic builds up in certain areas. But you can get usually a solution to it. You just need to start to think those through, and sometimes you have to be a bit creative on how you do it.
We could take the example of Spain. The Association of Car Manufacturers in Spain are very proactive towards the Spanish government, and it's not about congestion, but it's about size of the vehicle, size of the truck. And now they are about to have authorization on some dedicated routes to really enlarge the size of the truck, which brings a huge advantage on the logistic cost, especially for regular routes or loops where you really can build a comprehensive scheme. And I think that in that industry, the way the industry is organized to talk with states is really important. The problem we have in the EU is the lack of common regulation. I shouldn't say that in Great Britain, I know, in the UK, I shouldn't say that. But we really need to have a EU approach of corridors and kind of vehicle, types of vehicles to run on those corridors. And when it will become automatic vehicles, it's even more important to have a common approach of all countries. You know that we have a lack of drivers in some countries, not only Finnish vehicle ones. You know that in Eastern countries, they are now recruiting Ukrainian and Russian drivers outside EU to run in the EU. So we really need to think about congestion will not be only on the road, it will be also on the resources.
I think for me it's a combination of a couple of elements. To first exactly pinpoint your question, I don't have a factual data which says what this is the tipping point, but I think this is a key element we need to consider jointly with our service providers. First of all, we are not obliged to use always road transport. And hence, we are looking at multimodal transport ways. And two of our plants have railheads, which enables us to utilize the rail, which is a big enabler to take away the congestion. That's one. Definitely, that's one opportunity that we need to exploit. And however, still, the differences between the continent and the UK in terms of height and some kind of dimension wise is restricting us to have a complete loop. But these factors we need to work on jointly. We need to overcome to take away the congestion and take away the dependency on the road traffic. That's one. Second, what we are doing with our lead logistic partner is that we are looking at the network optimization. And this year we have changed our outbases, which outbases handling areas, handling points, to lessen the level of traffic and to move the trailers in a more efficient way so that we don't cause as much congestion, we don't leave as much carbon dioxide footprint, and we manage with less and working hours with our drivers. So this is a combination of all these factors which will contribute not only to lessen the traffic on the road, but also will have an impact on the CO2 footprint. And as we work jointly, as Luc alludes, like Spain, if you work jointly, and I think there are a lot of discussions in the SMMT regarding this. But we see we need to be more active in seeing the progression in the real life, because there, definitely if you go like this, there will be a tipping point. I can't exactly point out this date or this time, but we need to work more collaboratively to work on these initiatives to lessen, and also like the nighttime delivery kind of window. These are good initiatives, but we have to work collaboratively to make a more robust voice in getting some kind of reaction and working on these initiatives.
More questions? Okay, we focused a lot on the technology, quite rightly, but obviously, and also as we said in the sessions earlier, it's still very much a people business as well. And I was wondering about the next generation of automotive logistics, or logisticians. There's a kind of a personal interest in this because my son's working in logistics as well at the moment. So what is, you know, do we have a good group coming through? Is automotive logistics a career that people want to be in? Should it be a career that people should want to be in? And what should they be studying? Should it be supply chain management, or should it be applied mathematics or rocket science, as I studied when I was younger? you know, is there a group of... why are you laughing, Levin? No,
with your determination for the rocket science.
So is there a good generation coming through, perhaps Levin and Luc in particular?
Okay, and actually, we are looking at the future potential talent and how can we maintain the sustainability of and the interest that good talent is coming into logistics in logistics area. Because for some, we have identified, working with some universities, we have identified that people were not aware of how complicated and how deep subject this logistics is. And for looking from a surface, it may seem quite straightforward, or it may seem not so interesting. However, as we have made some introductory panels in the universities, we have good activities with Aston University and Warwick University, and this morning Richard has alluded about our activity jointly with the Warwick Technology Group. So we are inviting good talent with the initiative that it is not only transporting from A to B, it's more than that, and it's a real important subject, and it's a very important subject for our future. in terms of the CO2 footprint, in terms of the connectivity, in terms of using the, we have been discussing heavily on the information systems and IT technologies. So actually it's a very interesting area, and I'm very, very much happy working in this industry. But we need to get good understanding. We need to get good progression and traction of people's knowledge to invite the good talent. Mm-hmm. And we are looking at what kind of core competencies we will need 10 years later. Yeah. What the future will look like, and we are moving away, and we are trying to incentivize, we are trying to develop the future, people for the future. Mm-hmm. By giving them the for, we have different apprentice programs, we have different joint activities with the schools. So I think it's not only on the shoulders of the OEM. We have this group of very committed logistic service providers and partners that we need to leverage the understanding and the promotion of this, so that we can invite more talent in the logistics, so to maintain the sustainability and implementing of our good ideas in the future.
I would say that our business is quite attractive for engineers. At GEFCO, also because of our global footprint, I must say that we have no issues to attract young engineers, because they find real pleasure in going at work in the morning, saying, "Okay, I have a problem to fix. I have something to invent." So the image of our business is a business of poor, because margins, just look at the result of logistic companies, it's not Google and it's not Apple. And I really would like to have the cash of Apple to be a little more innovative, because the limits we have about innovation, it's not the skills of our guys. It's what kind of project do I seed, and how can I focus my resources on the right one. But it's very attractive. Once they touch that, they stay. Mm-hmm. Because it's much, much more attractive than other kind of businesses. Mm-hmm. At least everything about the engineering sphere. And then you have also the management sphere, because there is a lot of people behind that. Mm-hmm. And it's a very good school to learn how the management. So we need to communicate, we need to make that known. You know, in some cases, especially with my very first customer, I had to fix some rules in the contract to avoid my first customer to take my people. So in my new contract, I had to put that. Which means that logistic guys can have a value.
Mm-hmm. Questions? Question from the young man in the front.
Louis, the simple answer to your question is they must do the ECG Academy, of course.
Quite right.
So I didn't want to miss the plug. The ECG Academy. You've sent many people, Luc, over the past years. So, but I just wanted to say that I don't think people, many people don't specifically look to come into automotive logistics as a career. And you know, if they're coming through the OEM route, the sexy sides of the business are either sales and marketing, or they're the manufacturing side. And you know, I almost ended up in logistics by mistake. But in terms of what you teach people, it's Andy Goss's fault. And what you teach people is, it's hard. I think the best people I've recruited in this industry have been people perhaps who've come out of the armed forces, people who've got a can-do attitude, who've got problem-solving skills, who act independently and get on and do things. And engineers typically have that sort of state of mind, but some of those skills are quite difficult to teach people, and what you would recommend people to study at a university to come into the, quite difficult to say, outside of engineering, which is the obvious one.
But back to you, Mike, I don't know how long the academy's been going. It's been probably a few years.
We're just starting the 11th year.
So how much has changed in the, I don't know what you call it, the program? Is it more technical? Is it Is it more IT-based? What's changed in what you talk about, discuss in the academy, or what you teach in the academy?
Well, the first thing to say is I wasn't around when it started, so I can't go right back to day one. But I think we tweak it in some way every year based on input from the people who, the management, who send their people to the academy. Mm-hmm. And in the last couple of years, we've added a significant module on innovation. At the request of customers, specifically Daimler drove that one. We've added a module on contract law, because that was a new topic that was raised as something that people wanted to see included. So it's very much based on feedback from the people who send the students to the academy, and then we tweak it in conjunction with KPMG, who run it with us year by year, based on demand and feedback.
Yeah. All right. Thank you.
It's not really a question or a point, but it's maybe interesting to remember what we learned this morning from Cardiff Business School, which is the great majority of the students seem to be studying there in this area are from China, or from Asia, and I think that's probably true in some of the other programs. So I don't know what that ultimately means for the next generation of logistics providers, but I think that...
Can microphone at the front, please, just to continue that discussion, then we'll come back to you. Gavin, come on.
Yes, in terms of staff profile, we have a mixture of engineers. Probably about a quarter of my colleagues are engineers. Then we have geographers, town planners, we have lawyers, and then people who come from with an industry background. In terms of student profiles, it varies enormously from people with an engineering background or people who've done business before. And a few years ago, I had a girl from China, and her first degree was in Chinese medicine. And she came to study logistics, and she got a good job in logistics as a result of it. And our course is only a one-year MSc course. So one of our former pupils is here, and she told me the course was useful, so that's nice to know. But I think the diversity of our team is probably one of our valuable assets.
But how many of them want to do automotive?
I think that might be an issue. Automotive is a sexy industry, but I think it's a lack of awareness on the whole. I mean, personally, I, of course, push automotive very strongly, but I'm to some extent a lone voice. I have occasionally had complaints that there is too much about cars in my module, for example. Yeah. Some of my colleagues have a background in food logistics. They come from the supermarkets and things like that. Some of them have a background in implant logistics and operations management in factories and things like that. So one of the things, though, is that a lot of our examples, of course, a lot of the history of logistics does come out of automotive, if you think of the Toyota production system and lean production and stuff like that. So even my colleagues who are not automotive have to use automotive case studies and automotive examples. So I hope it all sticks eventually. And that some of my students have definitely ended up in the automotive industry, but we could push them a bit more, perhaps.
Thank you. And then was there a question in the middle?
While Gavin is walking, can I remind you all to start maybe filling in your evaluation forms if you haven't, because we will collect them perhaps in 10 minutes or so.
The majority of the people in the industry actually slide into it from a range of backgrounds. We still have skill shortages at all levels. The Chartered Institute of Logistics and Transport has a range of qualifications which are available from seats of learning or distance learning. But the main thing is that there is a new initiative called Think Logistics, which is actually creating awareness in schools and colleges with a careers charity called Career Ready. And they have been interestingly led predominantly from Northwest logistics providers, the likes of Abbey Logistics, DAF, Eddie Stobart, and they are actually making the industry available to 16 to 18 year olds as a career choice, either to go straight in through the apprenticeship route, and with the apprenticeship levy coming along, there are now many more opportunities to go into the world of work, get a living wage, and also learn on the job, as well as the formal route of education. And I think what we need to do is actually just raise the profile of all educational initiatives to actually increase the profile of logistics to school students before they leave and actually take the qualifications, so we can actually have highly intelligent cohorts of students going to Cardiff and the other seats of learning, or going into the industry and working for the OEMs and the other manufacturers.
Thank you. A question for Levent, really. You've been working on a couple of new, well, I don't know if you, but Jaguar have built a couple of new plants in Brazil, Slovakia, greenfield plants, I believe. So what have you done differently within the plants from a logistics point of view? You've got the opportunity to start afresh. Problem with existing plants, there's legacy, there's problems that you, or things that you can't change. What have you done differently in Brazil, or what are you planning to do differently in Slovakia from a logistics or plant logistics point of view?
Actually, this is a good question. Thank you for this.
Thank you.
It's wonderful. So, in terms of explaining the difference, I would like to take the Slovakian plant as an example, because in Brazil, it's still the bodies are dispatched from our Hayward operation. So it's not full-fledged production, mm-hmm. but Slovakia will be full-fledged production and full all operations with high volume and high tuck time operation. So for that, as you rightfully alluded, that our existing facilities are carrying a long history on them and which are not suitable to state of the art or best practice implementation because of the limitations and the facilities around them. And as I highlighted, and especially Richard has pointed out, the demand, it doesn't allow us to stop even for a weekend to stop and refurbish and to make some amendments, because it's ever continuing, which we are thankful about. But we have a limitation of what we can do and what we can renovate in the existing ones. But the point for the plant in Slovakia is going to be our benchmark facility. So what we have done, we have set very, very stringent targets for the plant. And we have our teams who have been working on this project for a long period of time to identify what is a best practice, what is a world-class manufacturing environment. So for that, in one hand, we made an intensive benchmarking, both internally and also we looked out other competitors, how do they do? Where are the best practices? And then we set ourselves very stringent, very challenging targets. How can we raise the bar over and above? And so far, the target setting is much more challenging than what we have in our existing operations. So, of course, it is in the planning phase, and we have reflected all the good learning and the good practices from our existing operations to reflect to this state-of-the-art facility. And I would like to see with yourselves in the coming times, as it comes to reality, that we would be proudly seeing the best practice and which would be a flagship for us to demonstrate the world-class manufacturing and then be in the forefront of the competition.
And I believe there's a magazine covering a great story in Jaguar Land Rover at the moment. So if you want to find out more about their operations, Automotive Logistics, I think it's called, and our Finnish Vehicle Logistics magazine as well. Yeah, so it should be in your pack.
Unfortunately, it's a pretty terrible journalist that did the story, I'm afraid. So.
Yeah. And no comment. I completely agree with Chris on that. So I think we're getting to the end. I just want to ask one more question really to Luke. We do, you know, there's this thing, you know, once if they sneeze in America, we catch a cold in Europe and so on. So one question for Luke, if we follow the American example, when Brexit, if Brexit happens, hard Brexit, will France pay for the wall?
France remains, you know. France is eternal. I think that the Brexit story is very far from an economic case. For sure, there will be negotiation, but it's far beyond that. I think that Brexit is, first of all, a very strong kick in a nice project that has probably lost a part of its initial value at a moment when Europe probably need such a project, so. But for us, Brexit will be probably demanding, but very interesting. I think logistic providers will have the opportunity to bring more value to their clients, because every time it's complex, I wouldn't say that I'm looking for complexity. I don't want to live in a more complex world. But what I can say is that when we look at GEFCO, when we think about why GEFCO exists, we say something like infinite proximity, something with everywhere and also with a very strong proximity to customer. Mm-hmm. And it's about complexity management. So yes, I don't know if France will pay, but GEFCO will exist.
And long may this complexity continue, because it keeps us in our jobs, both in the industry and definitely for the conferences.
I would like to add one thing. The week before, I have gathered the ExCom of GEFCO into a university very close to new technologies and innovation. And thinking about kicking the ass, I can tell you that the young guy is 20 years old, explaining us the 3D printing, showing us how you can print with metal at 1,200 degrees, how a robot can build a pedestrian bridge on its own in Denmark. Young guys of the same age explaining us how a drone is behaving, how you can have a self-piloted drone. All that needs to open the eyes of all guys like me, because I think that those things will really eat our business. I said truck without drivers, but I think it goes real far beyond that.
Mm-hmm. I think we have one last question, and then we can wrap up.
Hello?
Yeah.
Hi, this question is for Luc Nadal. See if you can help me. I've got a company, it's a logistics company also, but it's a bit smaller than the one you work. We employ 350 people.
Come closer, because you know, I'm not English, so I need to have all my brain. And if I can't listen to you,
it's all right. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. I've got a company also, a logistics company, but it's a bit smaller than GEFCO. So we employ 350 people. I would like to know what do I have to do in order for my company to be as big as GEFCO in 30 years?
I tell you what you need to do. You need to find your singularity, what makes you special. You don't look for growth, look for what you believe in and what you bring. And I'm sure that you bring something. If you focus on that, if you don't waste your time on other things, you will be a very nice target for GEFCO when we have when we will have the cash.
Yeah, I think we've put that up.
So maybe it's time to wrap up. So before we do, I'd just like to thank our panel for a great and very interesting discussion there. Thank you. Just like to remind you all about the evaluation forms. Particularly, they're always important, but particularly this year, because it's our first Automotive Logistics UK conference. You know, your opinions are very important. There will be a prize draw, so if you complete your form, you know, wave it in the air or whatever, so it can be collected. And there is a special prize for whoever we draw from the hat or bowl or whatever it is. It's a brand new Mercedes. Cap. Let me finish my sentence. So I've got to get to the other side somehow now. I don't know how many of you knew that I did study ballet as well as rocket science when I was a child, so you'll find how graceful I am. So. So we're still collecting the evaluation forms. They are genuinely very important to us, so please complete them and let us know your opinions. The conference doesn't finish, you know, at whatever it is, 9 o'clock tonight. It is, you know, you've all joined us, you're all partners of ours, whether you're delegates, sponsors, speakers. So if there's anything we can do for you regarding the conference, even after the conference, please let us know. You'll receive copies of the presentations in an email that will be sent out to you, the ones that we're allowed to reproduce. Some presentations are held back for various reasons, but the presentations that we're allowed to send out will be sent out to you probably the beginning of next week. The presentations will also be live on YouTube under Sleeping Cat with Children, or whatever the most popular videos are on YouTube nowadays. Now, we've got an automotive logistics kind of group, whatever they're called, on YouTube. So please see that. You'll see presentations from our Detroit conference a couple of weeks ago, our Europe conference earlier in the year, and the videos from this conference. So you'll be receiving all of this information in an email in a couple of days, as well as Chris and the editorial team's full report on the conference. Of course, you know, we've got the magazines and various online activities. So if you've ever got any news or stories for us, please let us know. If you've got any ideas for stories or suggestions, what you'd like to read in the magazine, please let us know, Chris and Marcus and Gareth and Robin and the team, on what we can do for you. If you did find the conference valuable for network and information sharing, then this isn't, strangely enough, the only conference we do. We do 11 around the world. I think four in the USA, another one in Mexico, China, Russia, Brazil. In fact, next ones coming up are actually India and Brazil, and then Mexico, and then a finished vehicle logistics event in North America. So it shows the global scale that we have. We've got our next European conference that many of you know, which will be in Bonn again, but will actually be in June. This year, or 2017, so please put that date in your diary as well. But again, you know, feedback, any information that you've got for us regarding the conferences. Have you got the evaluation forms ready? Or I'd also like to thank our sponsors who support us at the conference, who make the conference possible. They sponsor the conference. Not just to support us, but really because they provide services, products, knowledge for your industry. So please, if you've had a chance to visit their stands, meet their people, read their literature, or have a look at their websites if you haven't had the chance yet. So our gold sponsors, ABP, Comarc, Evolution, Time Critical, and Priority Freight. Our global sponsors, which means they sponsor all of our conferences around the world, are CDC, Beijing Changju Logistics, CHEP, CTM Law, GEFCO, and Wallenius Wilhelmsen Logistics. And our silver sponsors, Able, ARS Altman, Proact, Royal, and VNet. So please visit their websites, because we believe that they've got products or knowledge that's specifically for this industry. Are we ready to do the draw? Okay, I think we should do it anyway. We normally ask an attractive young lady to do the draw with me, but because my wife's here today, I thought we'd get for someone old and ugly. So Gavin, thank you for your... Is it Miss Kershaw? Greg Kershaw? No? Is she not here? Okay, we'll take another one. Let's just take the one. Don't make me get that one again. Oh, I'm having a lot of luck today. Oh, right, okay, I couldn't find the name. Richard Campbell from CHEP. Richard. Come on, collect your Mercedes cap. Actually said, Chris is a better moderator than Louis, so take that back, you can't have it. Oh, thanks, Richard. So thank you very much. I hope you've enjoyed the day. We've still got a great networking opportunity tonight, so I hope you'll be joining us for the dinner. Which proceeds straight after. I think Mercedes is part of this complex, Brooklyn's Museum, I think it is. There'll be human signposts outside, so we're going through the back exit of the hotel. So please join us for one last opportunity for networking, meeting people, sharing knowledge and exchanging business cards. But for us from here today, I hope you had a great couple of days, starting with the hot laps, some great sessions, the cocktail reception last night, a wonderful lunch, great coffee breaks with some wonderful treats in those as well, and a great first last session. So thank you very much, everybody. We look forward to seeing you back for Automotive Logistics UK 2017, which will be at the Belfry. So we look forward to seeing you there. Thank you very much, everyone. We'll be right back.